The universe remote is colored veil. Colored veil. What a beautiful phrase to see. Colored veil. Yes, all kinds of colors are there. Mental, vital, physical. All those things are there. One after the other, spiritual. They are all gone, 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 gone. The universe remote is colored veil. And at the unimaginable end of the huge riddle of created thing, period thing, at the end, what for we are here? Appeared a fast and godhead of the whole. See, he was wondering, who is that being? And Subhadip was wondering, who is that being who is guiding him? What does he say? Appeared a fast and godhead of the whole. His feet firm based on life's stupendous wing. So he is holding the powers, the aspects of life here under his command. Appeared the fast and godhead of the whole. His feet found base on life's stupendous wing. Omnipotent, a lonely seer of time. Inward, inscrutable with diamond gaze. He was wondering, who is that being? No. Is it a shadow being? Is it own imagination, his own creation? Now that is what he is seeing, who is that being? Attracted by the unfathomable regard, the unsolved slow cycles to their found return. Because that Godhead is there, so all the cycles, all the yugas, all these changes, all the eons which are there, they have found where they are supposed to go. To rise again from that invisible sea. They come and go. Cyclic movement keeps on going there because of that Godhead. All from his fusions born was now undone. Nothing remained, the cosmic mind conceived. Eternity prepared to fade. See, even that should disappear, fade, and seemed a hue and imposition on the void. Even that creation is a kind of an imposition on the void. Space on the flutterings of a dream that sank before its ending into nothing. Space was a fluttering of a dream. So you can imagine the dream is fluttering. That is space that sank, and that also sinks down below. Before its ending into nothing, said deep. So it has, where has that gone? Into the deep of nothing. Before its ending into nothing, said deep. The spirit died. Everything has gone, disappeared. There is no God, there is no self, nothing. The spirit dies. Sorry, the spirit that dies not, and the Godhead self seemed a myth. Even that appeared like an illusion, like a myth. Projected from the unknowable. Where from they have come? From the unknowable. They are myths. From it all sprang. In it is called to cease. So even the supramental world, the creation, the omniscience, the transcendental world, even that looks like a myth projected by the unknowable. From it, from that absolute, all sprang. In it, all cease. But what that was, no thought or sight could tell. That tat. The Sanskrit phrase, the Sanskrit word is tat. What that is, that tat, it is indefinable. You simply say that tat. Because it is absolute. It holds in it all the possibilities. But what that was, no thought or sight. I mean, all our faculties of cognition, what that was, that tat, savitur, we say later on, was that tat. Tat sat jyotir ravind. That is the mantra. Tat sat jyoti. No thought or sight could divine. All our faculties of cognition fail to understand, grasp it, hold it, what that is. They cannot. Only a formless form. Now this is a very paradoxical phrase, but you have to accept it. That's the only way by which it can be described. That's the only way by which it can be described. Only a formless, he is there, being there, that absolute is there, but it is formless. Arupa, rupa. In Sanskrit phrase will be arupa. Arupa. Formless. Form, rupa. Arupa, rupa. What is this form? Arupa. What is this form? Is arupa. What is rupa? Arupa. Only a formless form of self was left. A tenuous ghost or something that had been. Something as if very fragile, flimsy like that. Of course, something that had been. The last experience of a lapsing wave. The whole thing is a wave. Even the transcendent realization is also a wave of that absolute. And what happens? Even that wave disappears into the absolute. Lapsing. Collapse. Lapsing way before it sinks into a boundless sea, boundless. A sea which has no boundaries, no shores. There is absolutely no shores at all. Before it sinks, so that way also disappears into that sea. As if it kept even on the brink of naught, its bare filling with the ocean. Whence it came. A vastness brooded free from sense of space. So, we can see the infinite as a space only because of the sense. But what is there behind that space? A vastness, indescribable. It has no limits, no boundaries, no contours at all. An everlastingness cut off from time. So vastness, everlastingness. Well, in a certain sense, these are the attributes of the unknowable. He is, in a way, so to say, describing the unknowable. The unknowable, which is indescribable, which is not knowable, is being described as a vastness brooded free, an everlasting which no time can approach. A strange, sublime, unutterable peace. So it is vastness, it is everlastingness, it is peace. Silent, rejected from it, world and soul. So even the world does not exist, even the soul does not exist. A stark, companionless reality. Until now, it was intolerant, bare reality. Now here it is, bare reality is in a companionless. There is no companion at all. Nobody to give company to it. In fact, he is going to describe that thing. A stark, companionless reality answered at last to his soul's passionate search. So, this man is really pursuing the unknowable. At last, to his soul. So, it did answer to his soul. Passionate search. Passionless. See, his search is passionless. But the answer is passionless. The answer is wordless. The answer is fathomless peace. Keeping the mystery, none would ever pierce. It brooded inscrutable and intangible, facing him with a dumb, tremendous calm. It had no kinship with the universe because it is companionless. So it has no connection, no relation at all with the universe. It is companion. There was no act, no movement in its past. Life's question met by silence died on her lips, her on the lips of life. Died. The worst effort sees convicted of ignorance. Finding no sanction of supernal light, there was no mind there with its need to know. There was no heart there with its need to love. There were no strings there on the harp to play music, to play silence. A stringless harp. There was no heart there with its need to love. All person perished in its nameless name. So, all forms, all objects, all names, everything disappears into it. There was no second. It had no partner. It had no equal or peer. There was no second. It had no partner or peer. Only itself was real to itself. Alone, 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 absolute alone, companionless, peerless. There was no second. It had no partner or peer. Only itself was real to itself. Now this is the, again, the description of that bare reality, that companionless reality, you see. A pure existence, safe from thought and mood. So no thought can approach there, no mood can describe it. A consciousness of unshared immortal bliss, it dwelt aloof in its bare infinite, one and unique, unutterably soul. That is the companionless reality. So that is the description of that reality, you see, of that unknowable itself, you see. Being a being formless, you see, you are describing who is that being. A being formless, futureless, and mute, that knew itself by its own timeless self, aware forever in its motionless depths, uncreating, uncreated, and unborn. He is unborn, Swayambhu, self-born, uncreated. He is not created by somebody. He does not create, uncreating. He does not create, uncreating, uncreated, and unborn. The one by whom all live, who lives by none. So that is the description of that absolute. The one by whom all live, who lives by none. An immeasurable, luminous secrecy. Obviously it is secrecy. But what kind of secrecy? Luminous. Guarded by the veils or the unmanifest. Veils or the unmanifest.
And how I go?
He is guarded by the unmanifest.
Yes.
Veils. Now, this is a Vedic phrase, sorry, Upanishadic phrase. Veils of the unmanifest. This is a phrase which appears in the Upanishad. Now, guarded by the veils of the unmanifest. See, all the possibilities, all the potentialities which are there, they are the unmanifest. He is there, everything is present in him. All the possibilities of manifest. And those possibilities are kind of guarding him from manifestation. guarded with the veils of the unmanifest, above the changing cosmic interlude, about supreme, immutably the same, a silent cause occult, impenetrable, a silent cause, he the cause of everything. Occult, we cannot really find its secret, Guhya. Impenetrable, infinite, eternal, unthinkable, alone. Infinite, eternal, unthinkable, alone. That is the mantra. That is the mantra. Infinite, eternal, unthinkable, alone. That is the description of the unknowable. So he says it is indescribable, but he is describing it.
Infinite,
eternal, unthinkable, alone. You can see the way the whole thing spreads around, you see, that line. This is pure mantra, this line. Four words, of course, is infinite, of course, is eternal. He cannot be thought of, he is alone. But the music, the poetry, the rhythm brings a certain force, you see. Infinite, eternal, unthinkable, alone. So, well, this is the pursuit of the unknowable. Now, this section 79 or first canto of book 3. So, it has in all 42 sentences. So, in 42 sentences, he has described the unknowable, or he has reached the unknowable in 42 sentences. Actually, the total number of lines in this section is 154. This is what we had read now, just now. That whole section is made of 154 lines in 42 sentences. The number of lines is 154. Number of lines. And the number of sentences is 42. So in 154 sentences, sorry, in 154 lines, in 154 lines, we had a complete description of the unknowable. Absolutely. And see that last line, infinite, eternal, unthinkable, alone.
And he called the cosmic manifestation an interlude.
Yeah.
Acoustic
interval. Yeah. Yeah.
Very small thing.
So that whole unknowable is described in 42 sentences and 154 lines, you see. That is the magic of poetry. So now that's the background. Ashwapati was carrying the worst desire. He has climbed up now. He has to even give up that desire, worst desire, and meet the bare reality. To find out what the bare reality can do, he has to make a choice there now. As he said, either merge into that thing or transform it. Now it is that choice which he has to exercise, Ashwapati. And there, he sees that the solution lies only in the power which is there behind all this. the adoration of the Divine Mother. That is the next canto. Canto after that. He sees that power behind is absolute, who is working here. And therefore he approaches now the Divine Mother. He adores her, he offers his worship to her, he surrenders to her. He surrenders. And then he says, look, you have to come down again. But you have to take the mortal birth, you see. The adoration of the Divine Mother.